Greg, GoSet recently published an article called Pop is Dead. Is this the way you feel personally?
It was pretty close, actually. Ed Nimmerwald, who wrote the article, had pretty much the same grounding in rock that I did. He sees rock as a very personal thing. And the article protested against its commercialization, eventual death. I agree with most of his principles. It was sad because when I read it, it brought me down for about 3 days. And when I saw him just recently, he was still down because writing it was such an incredible thing for him, admitting that all his hopes for rock had fallen through.
You yourself, how are you coping with country radio? You are part of this, whether you like it or not.
Yeah. Well, I've gone through so many changes since the band's formed, that I'm sort of seeing things from two completely different sides. One from the publicity side, where as a newspaper man, it's my job and my life in a way to perpetuate the myth that all was groovy.
Don't you find though that a lot of the young people who make up your audience are musically undiscriminating?
Yeah, well that's the hard part. But then you only need to be a musician for 2 weeks to realise that. That's a hard thing actually to bear, to see a band get up for 4 hours and play nothing but one chord jam with you know, just banks of amplifiers screaming their heads off, meaningless empty music. That's just shattering to me, and very often bad musicianship to boot. And then see kids go off their heads at that, and then to see some worthwhile band get on stage, in my opinion, worthwhile, and play music that says something that has taste and beauty and gentleness and dynamics, and the kids, because it doesn't freak them out of their heads, can't understand it. And that's the saddest thing of all. Surely music, being an art form, is to be accepted and comprehended. As an artist, you have an obligation to pass on your art to kids. There's just so little art in rock now.
Greg, it seems that audiences have become very tired of not being able to participate.
Yeah, that's true. I'd hate to be among the kids who've grown up in the last 2 years with music, because it's been very difficult to participate. I think people need to dance, they need to have the physical immediacy of dancing. And I think the beauty of Daddy Cool and the sort of rock revival, which is peculiar to Australia, but that's another thing. The rock revival, the beauty of it is that kids are learning to dance again and learning to know what a joy it is.
Do you think promoters or recognise the need for smaller venues as we do?
As I said, you know, there'll be dancers and the kids will dance again, and there'll be small concerts, you know, very intimate things where personal music can come across, where there is room for beautiful, sensitive sort of stuff. And I hope so. In Australia, gradually there's a development. It started with the Aquarius tour, the university campus tour, and since then a lot of groundwork has been done in developing a university. Oh, no. Hello, GoSet. No, it's Greg. You just blew a GTK interview. Because I'm sitting here being interviewed, the film's rolling, and you ring the phone. Well, listen, I'll have to go. Can I ring you back? Okay. Right. Sorry.
Greg, do you feel any guilt that you may have been manipulating your audience over the last 2 years and turning them into pop culture?
No. I don't manipulate. I've never manipulated. I've never said anything in print that I haven't believed. To an extent, I've been trying to educate the readers and whoever I come in contact as a musician as well, into listening to valuable music. Not educate them as much as, you know, not indoctrinating them, but just simply pointing and writing about people that are valuable, people with things to say, people who, whether we like it or not, are the basis of the rock culture. People like Dylan and Chris Christopherson and Gordon Lightfoot, they just knew. So I mean, the last two, Christofferson and Lightfoot, knew. But I mean, their kind of music is the basis of rock. The Black Sabbath and Uriah Heeps and you know, and whatever comes after that are the tail end of it. You know, they're the empty shell of it. They're what's left now. So in a way, I guess I've been subconsciously directing people away from mindless music towards music which says something. But I wouldn't call that manipulation.